times of grace when the heart is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. And when I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire standing next to me. There was another in the waters holding back the seas. And should I ever be reminded of how I've been set free, there is a cross and there's a burden where another died for me. There is another in the fire. All my dead left were dead beneath the waters. I'm no longer a slave to my sin. Should I fall in the space between what remains of me and this reckoning? Either way, I won't bow to the things of this world. And I know I will never be alone. There is another in the fire standing next to me. There is another. There's a grace when the heart is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing
in. Would you pray with me, please? Lord, we come to you today and we thank you for the opportunity we have to gather. And God, we thank you that the promise of the gospel tells us that we will not walk through difficult times alone if we're believers, God. And my prayer is that each person here today knows you as their Lord and Savior. God, they may be walking through the valley of the shadow of death. They may be walking in the midst of a trial. They may be walking in the midst of a difficult circumstance or situation, God, but I ask that your presence be ever felt. And God, I ask for that to take place this morning as we're gathered together as the saints of your church, God, that you'll be pleased in the things that we say, pleased in the things that we sing, and pleased in the way that we conduct ourselves and live a life that brings honor and glory to you. Lord, we ask that you'll be pleased in all things, and we thank you for making this possible through the bloodshed of your Son. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, good morning to you guys. It is good to see you. I'm sure our Ole Miss fans are happy, and our Mississippi State fans not so much. And then there's a Notre Dame fan. He's lost. But anyway, so Alabama's better this week, right? Okay, you don't have to turn red this time, my man. That was awesome, though. But hey, we're glad that you're here. Glad that you're worshiping with us. If you are a guest this morning, we're glad that you're here and you're a part of our service. A couple of announcements, quite a few, to make you aware of a few things. Brother Bobby Wagner, a retired pastor, director of missions, sat over here to my right most of the time. He passed last night, yesterday evening. So if you'll be praying for Brother Bobby and Miss Brenda, as soon as arrangements are made, we will let you know when that will be, when that will take place, and I know they'd appreciate you praying for that. Immediately following our service this morning, if you want to help or are able to help with our fall festival, or if you have signed up to help with our fall festival, we're going to have a quick meeting immediately following the service this morning here in the sanctuary, so hang tight to go over a few things, a few logistics. That's one of our biggest outreach events, and it takes a lot of folks to pull that off, so we appreciate you being willing to do that. I'm going to ask you to pray for three things. First of all, tonight's the Rankin County Baptist Associational meeting. Brother Ben's going to be preaching, so if you'll be praying for him. But I've been nominated for the Executive Committee of Rankin County Baptist, and so I'm excited for that. That's taking place tonight. Why do they do it on a Sunday night? I was asked that today, because there's not many churches that have Sunday night service anymore, if you want to know the truth. And so that's one reason they're doing that. And also the crusade that's coming up at the Brandon Amphitheater, October 15th through the 18th. If you'll be praying for that, we're excited for that. We're going to have a luncheon here at the church for those that want to help with that. Hopefully you've already RSVP'd by now. But if you'll be praying for that event, God, that souls will be saved. And the last stat that we were given at that dinner was 80% of the metro area is unchurched. 72% of Rankin County, 80% of the metro area. So the harvest is there. And we just got to get them there and share the good news of the gospel with them. And then finally, the 23rd through the 25th of this month is the Mississippi Baptist Convention. So if you'll be praying for that, that event as well, or that meeting at the end of the day, I would appreciate that very much. But just reminding you to hang tight if you can help with the Fall Festival immediately following our service this morning here down front. You were probably given a worship guide when you came in. If you are a guest, you can tear that right side off, put it in the offering plate, leave it on the seat. We'll answer any question that you may have regarding our church. We're thankful that you're here and pray you receive a blessing of being a part of that. I know most of our kids are already there in the balcony, but if there are any kids here on the floor who would like to go to his kids this morning, if you'll make your way to the back right corner at this time, I'd appreciate it. Before I turn it back over to Brother Keith, Brother Ken Barfoot, our chairman of deacons, needs to make a quick announcement to you guys. Thank you.
I don't know whether to get a hail state in here or not. Anyway, good morning to you again.
Morning.
As many of you know, maybe some of you don't, the month of October has been set aside by Southern Baptists and Southern Baptist land, as we call it sometime, as Pastor Appreciation Month. At Flowood, we changed it a few years ago, kind of tweaked it a little bit to Ministerial Staff Appreciation Month, and that's kind of what we're going to go with, what we've been going with for the last few years. But with that being said, we want to show our appreciation to Brother Bobby and to Brother Ben and also to Brother Keith by taking up a love offering for them each Sunday of the month of October. We appreciate Brother Bobby's leadership in the, you know, the overall aspect of the church ministry here, Brother Ben's leadership in the youth and the student ministry, and of course Brother Keith's leadership in our choir and the music ministry here at Flowood. It's evident that these guys are called to serve here at this church, and by the way, he's blessed us down through the years. With that being said, if you'd like to show your appreciation for their leadership over the next several Sundays and Sundays in October, we're going to do this two ways. You can give cash if you'd like. Of course, everybody takes cash. Well, I don't know. Cash is getting hard to find sometimes, but we will take cash. And another thing is, if you would like to donate by check, if you would, make your check out to Flowood Baptist Church and be sure that you designate on that envelope what it's for, which would be Ministerial Staff Appreciation Month, and we'll take care of that. And we'll present this to these guys on the first Sunday in November. There'll be some guys at the back at the end of the service each Sunday to take those donations if you'd like to give and be a part of that. If you would pray about it, if you would like to be a part of this, we thank you for that and appreciate what you'll do. Thank you so much.
And I appreciate you guys being here this morning. So let's stand and sing. Join me on the call to worship on the chorus of He Lives.
He lives, lives, lives.
Thank you.
Father God, we come here this morning so thankful. We're thankful for this beautiful day you've given us. We're thankful to be a part of such a loving church family. And we pray this morning that your presence be felt. Now, Father, we bring back a portion of what you have given us. And we pray you will bless these tithes and offerings. In the name of Jesus, amen. Thank you.
This morning we're going to begin looking at the subject of temptation. We're going to look at it this Sunday and next Sunday of how to handle it, and then we're going to move into how to be real with ourselves, evaluating our own lives with the Word of God, not the opinion of man and what man may think. And so let's go ahead and get started. The mature person is patient in the midst of trials. When things are difficult, somebody who knows the Lord, somebody who is mature in Christ, is patient, knowing that God is going to use that for His honor and for His glory. But sometimes the trials are testings that are on the outside. They sometimes become temptations on the inside. Now, we need to understand there's a difference there. Trials may be sent by God. Temptations are sent by Satan. Don't get those backwards, all right? God cannot be tempted. I don't think God's going to tempt you. So a trial is sent by God. Temptation is sent by Satan. And Satan uses those temptations to encourage our fallen nature to continue to fall and to continue to go the opposite direction that God wants us to go. And so as you look at this idea, this is the second aspect of what James is teaching in his book, the book of James chapter 1. And he's looking at temptation being on the inside. Now, why did James try to connect the two? Why did he try to connect the trials by God and the temptations by Satan? What is the relationships with the testings within that can lead sometimes and testings on the outside? The answer is simple. If we are not careful, the testings on the outside may become temptations on the inside. If we're not guarded by the armor of God, in Ephesians, we know that, and we're not understanding the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, and the belt of truth, and the sword being that the Word of God, what we are dealing with on the inside that God is using for a trial can sometimes become a temptation on the outside. Which leads us to begin to look at our circumstances. When our circumstances are not what we want them to be, we often find ourselves complaining against God. We find ourselves questioning God's sovereign will. We find ourselves resisting what God is trying to show us and teach us and or direct us. And so Satan comes in and says, hey, I'm going to provide a way of escape. And that way of escape is through a temptation. And he allows it to look really good on the outside. He allows it to look flavorable for me and for you from our fallen nature. And we begin to fall short of the glory of God. This opportunity is what we call temptation. A couple of places in Scripture in the Old Testament that can relate to this idea of what James is teaching has to do with Abraham to kind of start off. Abraham had arrived in Canaan and he realized that there was a famine there. And because there was a famine, he couldn't take care of his herd. He couldn't take care of his flock. And so instead of using that opportunity to glorify God, Abraham says, I'm smarter than God. I'm going to flee to Egypt. I'm going to go to Egypt. I'm going to do what I want to do. Well, in that moment, he messed up. So many times our difficult circumstances or our trials are opportunities to bring honor and glory to God, but we run the opposite direction and we try to do it our way rather than allowing God to have it His way. A prime example is when we pray for things. Maybe you're praying for a relationship to be restored and we want to give up and you want to throw your hands up. That's not what the Bible calls you to do. The Bible tells you to be steadfast, anchored in the truth so God can glorify you. Or maybe you pray for someone to be healed that's been sick and you're asking God to heal them. And we begin to say this and ask God to do that. And then we see that this person passes away. And we say, God, why didn't you answer my prayer? He did. He did. If they know Jesus as their Savior, that person is healed, right? But the human aspect that says we want them healed and want them to be here, and there's nothing wrong with that. But in our prayers, it's often God heal them, right? God work with them. God guide them and direct them. But if they know Jesus, they understand what it means to be healed if God calls them home. The nation of Israel wandered in the wilderness. We know they did it for many years, and no sooner had they been delivered from Egypt, the water supply vanished. Then they had to march around for 3 days and didn't have any water. And then they finally get water, and it's bitter. It's not what they want. It's not pure. They're not excited about it. And what do? They begin to gripe. They begin to complain. They begin to question God. They begin to ask God, why is this happening? Why are you allowing this trial to cause so many problems if we are your chosen people? Now understand that God does not want us to yield to temptation. He does not want us to yield to temptation, neither can He keep us from experiencing temptation. Why is that? Well, we're not sheltered people, we're scattered people. As a believer, you're not a sheltered person, you're a scattered person that is scattered abroad to share the good news of the gospel so Christ can use you and Christ can use you to bring honor and glory to Him. This morning, it's our first point of this morning. We're going to look at our main point and we're going to look at it again next week. But the first thing that I want to bring to your attention is we must consider God's judgment. We must consider God's judgment. When we're not focusing on God and our eyes are not fixed upon Him, we need to focus and realize that His judgment is, in fact, real, and He will get our attention one way or another. James chapter 1, beginning in verse 13, it says, "Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth He any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Do not err, my beloved brethren." This is a negative approach. You may say, well, y'all know anybody who has a negative view on things? I mean, you expect the worst to happen. I'm one of those guys, right? I expect it all the time. No matter what it is, I expect it to go the opposite direction, no matter what somebody may say. But James is saying here, it's a negative approach, but you need to pay attention to the negative approach, and it's simply this. Look ahead and see what happens. Look ahead and see where sin ends. That's death. Sin ends at death, separated from Christ from all eternity. Don't blame God from temptation. He's too holy to provide temptation for you in the first place. Don't blame God for the things that you're doing. But as you look at what God did for Abraham, He tested Abraham in Genesis chapter 22. And Abraham failed the test. Abraham did not do what he was supposed to do. He did not keep his eyes fixed upon Jesus. And so as you look at Genesis 22, you look at James chapter 1, what is the definition of temptation? I believe it's this. It fits this definition in both of these places. A temptation is an opportunity to accomplish a good thing in a bad way out of the will of God. A temptation is an opportunity to accomplish a good thing in a bad way out of the will of God. So let me give you an example. Is it bad to pass a test? No. Is it wrong to cheat and pass a test? Well, that's debatable. No, it is wrong, right? We understand that. Is it wrong for us to cheat in math class like I did? I mean, I did that. Look, everybody else is like, yeah, that's me too. I see you back here, folks. Here, right? Walt knows completely. If it wasn't for me, Walt might not finish Colin. Isn't that right? I lie for you every time, man. I ask for forgiveness for it. I'll be honest, but I'm glad you're here. But the idea is it's not wrong to pass the test. It's wrong of how we pass the test. You understand? It's not wrong that we make money. It can be wrong how we're making the money, whether it be ethically or morally wrong, right? Or not doing it the way that God wants us to do it. It's not wrong to eat, but gluttony is a sin. It's not wrong to eat, but stealing the food to eat is a sin. So we see here that it's when you take a good thing and you get it in a bad way outside the will of God. And we think so oftentimes that sin is one act. Sin is a process. And I'm going to try to show you that process this morning. And we're going to answer this question. What is the process of sin? As we consider the judgment of God, we're going to answer the question of what is the process of sin based on James chapter 1, beginning in verse 13. Now, we know that Adam committed one sin. And because of the one sin of Adam, the human nature inherited his genes, per se, or inherited his fallen nature. But we know that God sent a second Adam named Jesus to fix what the first one messed up so that we can be reconciled and restored through the bloodshed of Jesus Christ. There's no other way for someone to be saved, all right, except the blood of Jesus Christ. So what is the process of sin? There's 4 points of this question, and the first is simply the desire. It begins with a desire. You know, you may say, well, my heart's desire is this, or my heart's desire is that. Or my life's desire is to retire at 55, or my life's desire is to get married and have children, to have a good job, have a nice home. It begins with desire. How do we know? Look at verse 13 with me, or verse 14 with me in James 1. "But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed." Now, the word lust there means any type of desire. It's not necessarily a sexual nature, but the word there means any type of desire. God has given us normal desires. He has given you a desire to get up and go to work every day. I believe He created us that way. He has given us the desire to seek His face. He's given us a desire to eat when we're hungry. He gives us a desire to lay down or sleep when we are tired or fatigued. The problem is that when we take the normal desires of God and twist them or pervert them with the mindset of Satan. So now we're saying, hey, you know what? I'm not going to work. I'm going to live off the government, and I'm not going to allow anybody to do anything. I want everything handed to me. And then we say something, well, you know, it's life's about me, and I don't care what anybody else thinks. I'm going to live a prideful human life. And so when you look at these ideas and understand what's happening here, the desires that God has given us are good. The problem is when we seek those desires outside of the will of God and we attain those outside of the parameters there that God has created us to do. Look at Hebrews chapter 13, verse 4. It's an example for marriage. Marriage is honorable and the bed undefiled, but whoremongers and adulterers God will judge. When you look at that verse, or you look at where we are in James chapter 1, what I call super spiritual people, they try to suppress the good things of God and begin to question how you're doing those things. They begin to question you of how you're attaining those or how you're getting from point A to point B. But the reality is these fundamental desires are what make you move. For example, if you take the steam out of a boiler, you have no power. You understand that, right? That's what causes the boiler to work. But if you allow the steam to have all the power with no control, you have destruction. So there's a constant consistent in our life. The constant consistent in our life is the Word of God that teaches us these boundaries, that teaches us what our desire should be. You may say steam is a good thing. Steam is a good thing if it's used right. A vehicle is a good thing if it's used right. Your eyes, your thoughts, your actions are good things if they are used right. There must be a consistent or constant control of our life so that our desires are found in the right place. So many times in the world today, even in church life, we desire things that are not biblical. We desire things that are not found in the Word of God. We desire things based on what man is telling us rather than what the Word of God is teaching us and showing us all throughout Scripture. So what is the process of sin? It begins with desire. Number two, it leads to deception. It leads to deception. Your desire is XYZ. You have an image of your head of what it's going to be, and so then you step off and you realize that you've been deceived, which is the second process of the process of sin. Again, James 1:14. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. You know this. I know this. No temptation appears to be temptation, right? We first see it. It doesn't appear to be temptation used by the devil to cause us to sin. And James here uses two words from the sports world to kind of get our attention. The first one we see is drawn away and enticed. Drawn away in the original Greek carries the idea of building a trap. Maybe you're building a trap for hogs. Maybe you hog hunt, or a coon trap, or a squirrel trap. You understand. You have this food there. You have this corn on the ground, and you're enticing the hog to go into this trap. And if you know how this works, they walk in. Either the door drops behind them or the entire round pen drops above them. Then you go in there with a heyday, and you shoot them. And you understand that. But that's what it is. It looks good to them. They want the corn. They're not worried about the surroundings. They're looking at what is drawing them away. The second word is enticed. It carries the idea of baiting a hook. Y'all fished before. You don't just throw a hook out there and fish, right? You put some type of bait on it, whether it be a minnow, a cricket, a beetle spin, whatever it is, a topwater bait, because you know a fish not going to bite just an empty hook. But you have to throw something that gives it. And that's what Satan does. He dangles it in front of us. We see it. It gets our attention. There's a desire. He does it again. Now he's really got our mind working. And the third time, we're like, oh, yeah, this is for me, right? This is for me. This is where I'm going to make the move. And he is trying to hide what's ultimately around them. When you think about the hog again, he's trying to hide the trap. When you think about fishing, he's trying to hide the hook. He's trying to get our eyes fixed upon something that is not the Word of God. Temptation always carries some type of bait that appeals to our natural desires. Temptation always carries some type of bait that appeals to our natural desires. Temptation is not going to be biblical. Temptation is not going to be spiritual. Temptation is not going to be of God. The bait attracts us. We see it. We like it. We go get it. But it hides the fact that it is yielding to destruction. It hides the fact that that is just the surface level. It hides the fact that the bait is the exciting thing, but the move after that is what brings destruction. Let me give you a biblical example. I'm going to give you a couple of them. Lot. Lot would have never moved towards Sodom and Gomorrah had he not seen that it was well watered. Look at Genesis chapter 13. Genesis 13:10 says, "And Lot lifted up his eyes and beheld all the plain of Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere." He would have not gone had he not seen the bait. You agree with that based on Genesis chapter 13? But he saw that and he went, "David would not have committed the sin that he committed of adultery had he seen the tragic consequences." What were those tragic consequences? The death of a baby, Bathsheba's son, the murder of a brave soldier, Uriah, the violation of a daughter, Tamar. The bait keeps us from seeing the consequence of sin. And I can tell you that everyone in here, including myself right here in the pulpit, has failed at temptation. We have yielded to temptation. We have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, whatever the temptation may be. It may be something we mentioned. It may be something that we didn't mention. But the reality of the moment is this. Satan is going to attack you when you are the most vulnerable. Satan is going to attack you when you're not in the will of God. But then again, Satan is going to attack you when you're close to Jesus as you're ever going to be, because he wants to derail you. He wants to hurt you. He wants to bring you down. Y'all know that Jesus was tempted by Satan? Most of you know the story here where Jesus is in the wilderness and he was hunting. The idea of turning the stones to bread there, and Satan looks at him and says, "Well, if you say who you are, why don't you turn it to bread?" And three times Jesus Christ says, "It is written, it is written, it is written." What does that tell us? It tells us that he yielded to the word of God and he didn't yield to the bait of Satan. If Jesus quotes the word of God, guess what, folks? You'd better quote the word of God and I'd better quote the word of God. If he yielded to the word of God more than the temptation of the devil, then we need to do the same. The Bible gives us what we need to detect the temptation, to detect the bait, and to act decisively. If you're not in the word of God, you're not going to be able to see it. Understand that. If you're not studying the Word of God, you're not going to be able to see the things that God wants you to see. Process of sin. Desire, deception leads to the third, disobedience. It leads to disobedience. Being out of the will of God, doing what you want. There have been times in my life that I have been out of the will of God, even as a pastor of this church. I'm not going to sit here and say that that's not happened. But the good news of the gospel is restoration is possible. Reconciliation is possible. Because the same God that works in your life is the same God that works in my life. And nothing is too big for our Lord. But when we begin to look at sin and we see the desire and we adhere to the deception, it leads to our action, which is disobedience, in James chapter 18. Chapter 1, verse 18. "Of his own will begot he us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures." We've looked at the emotions, the desire. We've looked at the intellect, the deception. James moves from hunting and fishing, the baiting of a hook, to the entrapping of an animal, to the birth of a baby. Now, what is James trying to show us? Desire conceives a method for us to take the bait. And when we take the bait, it leads to what? Disobedience. And when we are disobedient, the will approves and acts, and the result is sin. Then we're hooked, and now we're trapped. When you're hooked and you're trapped, so many times we don't know what we're going to do. But we need to realize that the baby is born, and when a baby is born, the goal is what? For that baby to mature. And we as parents do what we can do to help our babies mature, help our babies to grow up, help our babies to make good decisions. And that's the same thing as the Word of God. When you're a believer, the Word of God and the power of the Holy Spirit helps you to grow, helps you to mature, helps you to make the right decisions. A Christian living, when you really understand Christian living, it is a matter of will, not feelings. Christian living is a matter of will, not feelings. Let me give you an example. You ever heard somebody say something like this? "Hey, I just don't feel like reading the Bible today." Or have you ever said it? Here's one that I hear all the time. "I just don't feel like going to church." You ain't got to go to church to be a Christian. Okay. Now, valid. Theologically, you don't. But you're commanded to gather with the saints. Right? That's what it says. You're commanded. Well, the Sabbath was Saturday. I mean, we're going to do the Levitical system now? Okay, let's gather instead of watching college football. How many of y'all going to be here next Saturday? Thank you. My point is, so many times we say, I don't feel like doing it. You know, children operate off of feelings. Children operate off of feelings. Adults operate off of will. It's about time we start acting like adults. Because so many times our feelings cause us to stumble. So many times our feelings cause us to look a little different. Your child responds out of hurt. Your child responds out of what you say. Your child responds out of what you do. They respond out of feelings. An adult is to respond out of their will. This is why there's so many immature Christians that want to leave the church all the time. This explains it right here in this moment, because our feathers get ruffled because of this or that, and rather sitting under true biblical teaching, we want to take our toys and go to another sandbox because somebody offended me. The Word of God is going to offend you because you're sinful and I'm sinful. And we can argue about all these things, and we can send text messages to the preacher about all this stuff, and we can talk to all these deacons about this or that. I got both fans going up here because it's 71 degrees up here. But the idea is we can argue about things that don't matter, or we can get on the same boat and impact the kingdom of God. That's what the Word teaches. That's what we are. That's where we are. But so many times we fall into temptation. So many times we fall into what we want. What does Philippians 2 say? Philippians 2:13 says this, for it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Now, working inside of you is not your mama. It's not your daddy. It's the empowerful Holy Spirit of God. The one that tells you to get up and go to church and make it a priority, it's the will of God. God works, God moves. It's our responsibility to adhere to it. What is the process of sin? Desire, deception, disobedience. And death is your final point. The final process of sin is death. Verse 15, then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it finished, bringeth forth death. Disobedience gives birth to death, not life. Running from God gives death. Seeking God gives life. If we obey God's word and we understand what it is, we're not going to yield to this temptation. Why? Because God has erected a barrier because he loves us. Ezekiel 18 says, have I any pleasure at all that the wicked should die, saith the Lord God, and not that he should return his ways and live. God desires to protect you. God desires to guide you. These four points of sin, desire, deception, disobedience, and death is found in the biblical account of Adam and Eve in Genesis chapter 3. If you will go to Genesis for a moment, if you have your Bible, otherwise it'll be on the screen, but you're going to see this particular process unfold in the first book of the Bible. Where sin entered the world, you can see this process. Go to Genesis chapter 3, beginning in verse 5, and you're going to see in verse 5 and 6 that the serpent used desire to interest Eve. The serpent used desire, which is your first point, right of the process, to get Eve's attention. Look at verse 5. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be open, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. Verse 6. And when the woman saw the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. Desire is found in verse 5. The desire that Satan used is this. If you eat of this fruit, you eat of this tree, you're going to be wise. You're going to know good and evil. You're going to know what God knows. And we see that after Genesis 3, 5, and 6, that her desires were aroused. Look at what Paul says about the deception of Eve in 2 Corinthians. Stay in Genesis. It says, but I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. Satan is a deceiver. Satan wants you to fail, and Satan seeks to deceive your mind. If Satan can get in your head, he's going to get in your heart. If Satan can get in your head, he's going to get in your heart. And I know what's in some of y'all's head. You don't need Satan there too. You know what I mean? You need to realize that there's a hedge of protection there, that God is going to see a way. So the bait that he used, listen, you know, the enticement or the drawing away, The bait that Satan used to Eve was the fact that this forbidden tree was good. That this forbidden tree was good and pleasant. And because it was good and pleasant, it would be something that she now desired because she wanted to be wise. There's step two, Genesis 2, verse 17. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat thereof. For in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. Desire, deception. We're going to know disobedience and death. Eve disobeyed God. Eve disobeyed God by taking the fruit and eating it. Then Eve walked over to Adam and said, hey, Adam, won't you eat this here? It's going to make us good and wise. But if you know the story here, Adam was not deceived, but Adam sinned with his eyes wide open. And because he sinned with his eyes wide open, it is his sin that plunged the entire human race into tragedy. Because his eyes were open and he still did it. Same thing for us. You understand? You with me? When we see the desire, we see the deception, and we respond with disobedience, now we're having to fix the mess up. Now we're having to respond in a way that we're not supposed to. And because he's sinned with his eyes wide open, we can understand 1 Timothy chapter 2. And it says this, and Adam was first formed, then Eve. And Adam was not deceived, but the woman being deceived was in the transgression. Notwithstanding, she shall be saved in childbearing if they continue in faith and charity and holiness with sobriety. Eve was deceived. Adam just flat was disobedient. And because of that, immediately those two individuals experienced spiritual death. There's your fourth step of the process. Not only spiritual death, but they experienced physical death too. And we know, biblically speaking, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that all men die because of Adam. And it says in verse 21, for since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. But here's the good news. You don't have to experience spiritual death for all eternity. You may say, preacher, you don't know what I've done. You don't know what I've done. You may say, you don't know what Ken's done. You don't know what Les has done. You don't know what Richard's done. It would be great if the church would quit worrying about what everybody else has done and focus on what we're not doing. It made my life so much easier, Bo. I tell people all the time, my job is dealing with people like Matt Limley. I'm kidding. The easiest part's preaching. The easiest part's singing. The difficult part's dealing with difficult people. But the good news of the gospel is this. Even though you fall short and you fall to temptation, your desires change, you're deceived, you're disobedient, you do not have to experience eternal separation from Jesus Christ. But if you do not accept the Lord, Revelation chapter 20, it's five verses. I want you to read this with me. It says in verse 11, and I saw a great white throne and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. Here it is. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. There's going to be a lot of people that's names are on the roll of a church that's not going to experience a place called heaven. And if we quit worrying about our name being on the church roll and a committee of the church and start worrying about our name being in the Lamb's Book of Life, life's going to be really good for this church. Life's going to be really good for this church. But our desires must be, and we need to understand Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. You do not have to succumb to the death spiritually. You can be alive in Christ. You can accept Jesus as your Savior. And your name can be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. What's more important to you, church? Folks seeing your name on a roll? Or your name being written in Christ's blood and shall not be blotted out? Because if it's the latter, God's going to work in you. God's going to use you. And when you're faced with temptation, you're going to know how to handle it because you're in the Word of God? Answer this question. Is my name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? If it's not, today's the day, my friend. I don't care if you're 17, I don't care if you're 90. Today is the day of salvation. When one person comes to know the Lord, I believe the Bible teaches that all heaven rejoices. Let's pray. Lord, we come to you and we do thank you for the power of the gospel. And God, we thank you that no matter what we face in life, you give us what we need to face those difficult circumstances. And God, we ask that in this moment, my prayer is simply this. If there's anyone here today who doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, today's the day. If there's anyone here who's been struggling with a sin or temptation that needs forgiveness and restoration and reconciliation, God, today's the day. And God, if there are folks here that are allowing Satan to mess with their mind, God, I pray today they will declare in the mighty name of Jesus that we sang about, another in the fire. There is no other name but the name of Jesus. But God, you will allow the power of the gospel and the power of the name of Jesus to guide their minds, to direct their minds, and give them the thoughts of the gospel. God, I believe there are folks here today who need to make a decision. Salvation, membership, rededication, or just a time of prayer. God, may you convict them to do that. And we'll be careful to give you the honor and glory for it. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. Let's stand for a second.
you'll have a seat for just a moment. Rayleigh, if you'll make your way up here, Corey, Nicole. It's after 11, but this is worth it, I promise, okay? She looks excited. This past week, Brother Ben met with Rayleigh Wednesday night, but after a conversation with Corey and Nicole, and she has prayed to accept Jesus Christ as her personal Lord and Savior, and we believe that she's made that decision, and the counsel with Brother Ben and Corey and Nicole feel like they're confident in this as well. So she's standing before you as a young lady who's now your sister in Christ, and we're excited for that. And would you give her a warm Flowood welcome? All right. You good? All right. Rhonda, if you'll come up here for just a second. Just hang tight right there. Rhonda Gunner, most of y'all know who she is, and Carly, been here for quite some time, and she sent a message to me earlier this week that the Lord had been working on her life and asking God to just move, and she's coming before you to rededicate her life, and she wants to follow the baptism as well, and we're excited for that, and there's a lot going on in people's lives that we don't know. I'm not just saying it about her, but everybody in here has got things going on. The best thing we can do is be kind and to love others and encourage them. So she's standing before you, rededicating her life to the Lord and asking God to move in her life, to be used for Him and for His glory. So I'm going to ask you to pray for her as she does this, and pray for their home life, pray for her work life, pray for Carly, and that God will just continue to move in her midst and just walk alongside her during this time. The good news of the gospel is this: we're not alone, right? Salvation is individual, but walking through life together is collectively, and that's what she's asking you guys to do. Pray for her and walk alongside her and teach this little one here what it means to be a disciple of Christ, to follow there. I'm going to ask them to come in the back. They will be in the back. If you have a second to come by and speak to them, just a quick reminder, we will have a meeting about the Fall Festival as soon as the service is over. All right? Thank you, Brother Key.
Let's stand as we sing. Oh, the King is coming.